This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us be glad and rejoice in it. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. For God has shown thee what is good. And what does the Lord require of us but to do justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with our God. Good morning. We welcome you this morning to the Andrew Rankin Memorial Chapel. And we pray God's blessings upon you as we seek to worship our God in spirit and in truth. This morning, we are indeed blessed to hear a message from one of this generation's prolific preachers and pastors, the Reverend Matthew Watley. Reverend Watley is a senior pastor of the Kingdom Fellowship AME Church of Silver Spring, Maryland, and a former graduate assistant here in Rankin Chapel. Pray for him as he comes to bring us a word from the Lord.
This week's scripture comes from Psalm 146, verses 1 through 8, and it reads, praise the Lord, O my soul. I will praise the Lord as long as I live. I will sing praises to my God all my life long. Do not put your trust in princes, in mortals, in whom there is no help. When the breath departs, they return to the earth. On the very plans they perish. Happy are those whose help is in the Lord of Jacob, whose hope is in the Lord of their God, who made heaven and earth, the sea and all that is in them, who keeps faith forever, who executes justice for the oppressed, who gives food to the hungry. The Lord sets the prisoners free and opens the eyes of the blind. The Lord lifts up those who are bowed down. The Lord loves righteousness. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Tragedies are commonplace. All types of diseases, people are slipping away. Economy's down, folks don't get enough pay. But as for me, all I can say is thank you, Lord, for all you've done for folks without homes are in the street, and the drug habits, some say, they just can't beat. Muggers and robbers, no place seems to be safe, but you've been my protection every step of the way, and I want to say thank you, Lord, for fit to let none of these things be. Every day by your power, you keep on keeping me. And I want to say thank you, Lord, for all you've done for me. Hey, hey, could have been me.
Tragic end, oh, but you didn't see fit to
Let us prepare our hearts and minds for prayer. Let us be still before our God.
Let us pray. Most gracious and loving God, before any human hands touched us, you already knew us. You are closer to us than even our own thoughts. You know us, and still you love us. Thank you for loving us. Thank you for all that you have provided, for what we too often take for granted, especially the precious gift of being alive. We thank you, O God, for your loving kindness towards us, for not giving up on us even when we gave up on ourselves. That is why we come to you, for you have been for us a healer more than a judge. We come confessing, O God, that there are times when we find ourselves feeling as if life has passed us by. We harass ourselves with guilt over the mistakes we have made and convince ourselves that it's too late and things will never change. Too often we feel stuck. In our minds we know what we want to do, but we can't seem to do it. There are times, O God, when blaming others becomes our only escape. O God, in those moments, rescue us from ourselves, from what we think about ourselves, from what we say to ourselves. Cause us to think your thoughts, to see the good in ourselves, to be gentle to ourselves, to be more patient with ourselves, to see beyond what we are struggling with, to accept your forgiveness, to feel the love that you have for us, to believe that we are more than what we think we are, to know that beyond yesterday's failures and accomplishments, you still have more for us. And then, O God, help us to believe that we can be healed. We open now our hearts, our minds, and our souls to receive your healing. Come now, Lord, and heal us. Come now to our secret places, our hurting places. Come now and heal us. Heal our loved ones who need more than we can provide. Heal all who are walking with grief. Come to all who, even in this moment, feel anonymous, who know the pain of loneliness. Come to us who are poor and in prison. Then, Lord, come and heal our nation. Shaker, disturb her if you must. Do anything you want with her, but please don't leave her to herself. Don't leave this nation to the hatred, the bitterness, the greed, the racism that is consuming her. Cause us to make this nation do what is right. Enlarge the borders of our hearts to welcome the stranger. Fill our hearts with compassion. Let it be like fire shut up in our bones, rendering us unable to be silent in the face of so much that is wrong. Come now, Lord, and heal our nation. We're not going to tell you how to do these things this morning. We're just going to let go, and we're going to trust you. We're going to trust you that you will lead us and guide us to that place of wholeness. Hold us now, O God. Hold us now in your love until we learn how to love. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
From the time I was a little child, I'd always heard of you, but I wondrous things that you could do. But in spite of all I'd seen and heard, still this question came to me. Why must I suffer so if the Father knows what's best for me? Hallelujah. As my nights and days turned into months, I watched my months turn into years. I could see the devil trying to turn my trust into doubt, trying to turn my faith into fear. But God delivered me from all that bitterness. Through that darkness, I could see that there was a reason for the test. And the Father knows what's best for me. So with everything within me, I say yes to thee, O Lord. Now I know that my faith is not weak. I'm standing on your word. Oh, forgive me, Lord, for the times I doubted you, when your ways I could not see. Lord, I'll just rest assured that you know what is best for me. So let the fainting heart take courage. Let the weak one say, I am strong. Exchange your gloom for gladness. Give him your suffering, he'll give you a song. Do not cast away your confidence. Didn't he promise to see you through? God knows just what to do. The Father knows what's best for you. Oh, so with everything within me, I say yes to thee, O Lord. Now I know that my faith is not weak. See, I'm standing on your word. Oh, forgive me, Lord. Forgive me, Lord. Forgive me for doubting you when your ways I can't see. Lord, I'm just rest assured. Hey, I said, I'll just rest assured. Oh, Lord, I'll just rest assured that you know what is best for me.
Well, this is the day that the Lord has made. We are rejoicing and we're glad in it. Allow me just to take a moment of personal privilege to express my deep and heartfelt appreciation for Dean Bernard Richardson, my mentor of many years, and proudly to say my friend, for this signal honor to once again share with the Andrew Rankin Memorial Chapel. Having graduated both with undergraduate and graduate degrees from Howard University, and formerly served as a graduate student trustee on the Board of Trustees, and now sitting on the Board of Visitors for the Howard University School of Divinity. Let me just say how much I have been praying for my beloved alma mater as we have gone through a very challenging season. And I'm reminded of how, at a very young age, I decided that I wanted to find out how my alarm clock worked. And so I got a pair of pliers and some screwdrivers and went to work. And within a short amount of time, I was able to pull off the top and to investigate how the motherboard operated. I was able to take off several of the pieces on the inside. I discovered everything I wanted to discover. But when it came time to put it back together and get it functioning again, I wasn't able to do it. I didn't have to go to school to pull it apart. I didn't have to have any training or any assistance to deconstruct it, because deconstruction is easy. And there are times where we need to go through the deconstruction process. But my prayer for Howard is that now that we've been through this process, that we'll come together and that we'll be healed and whole and move forward in our mission, truth, and service. Let us pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we glorify you and we praise you, because in everything you call us and cause us to give thanks. And so, God, in the midst of a trying time on campus, in the midst of a trying time because of the COVID pandemic, in the midst of a trying time because of the chaos and confusion in our country, God, we pray for your healing balm, that you might grant us what we need as we need it to be your ambassadors and your witnesses here on earth. We pray now, God, that your spirit might yet move and speak and touch through the declaration of your gospel. Speak right now. Your servants are listening, and have you choose to move, we'll be careful to give you the credit. We'll say that Jesus did it, for we ask these blessings in his mighty name. It's in Jesus' name we want to say thank you. And all God's children said, amen. Well, my brothers and my sisters, God has a word for us today. It's found in the gospel according to John, the 11th chapter, beginning reading at the 38th verse. And there, these words are recorded. Jesus, once more deeply moved, came to the tomb. It was a cave with a stone laid across the entrance. Take away the stone, he said. But the Lord said, Martha, and the sister of the dead man, by this time there is a bad odor, for he has been there 4 days. Then Jesus said, did I not tell you that if you believe, you will see the glory of God? So they took away the stone. Then Jesus looked up and said, Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I said this for the benefit of the people standing here, that they may believe that you sent me. When he said this, Jesus called in a loud voice, Lazarus, come out. The dead man came out, his hands and feet wrapped with strips of linen and a cloth around his face. Jesus said to them, take off the grave clothes and let him go. Thus far, the word of God, as the Spirit does speak and God does guide. I just want to use as a sermonic subject for the next few minutes, thanks in advance. Thanks in advance. Brothers and sisters, you know this term very well, thanks in advance for your assistance, because it's one of the most commonly used salutations of formal correspondence. Thanks in advance presumes that the party that is being addressed is predisposed to be helpful. In fact, it assumes that the party is able to be helpful and that the party is going to be helpful. Understand that this term, thanks in advance, is more than merely a rhetorical flourish, but rather it is designed to influence the individual that is being addressed. The intent is, if one was not necessarily interested in my issue or in my request, then my simple thanking that person in advance is designed to help to move them to desire to go out of their way to be helpful to my circumstance. Brothers and sisters, I raise this to your consideration because I want to commend these words, thanks in advance, to you for any time you're in correspondence with the author of all of the universe. That is to say that when you go down on your knees to pray, when you sit quietly in meditation, when you fast and seek the face of God, when you worship God for who he is, just my suggestion is you ought to slip these words in there somewhere, thanks in advance, because your God is predisposed, is able, and is going to be helpful. In fact, you need to know that before you raise your prayer, God already knows the content and concern of your prayer, and God is willing to come down and see about you. Therefore, when we pray with thanksgiving. We pray a presumptive sort of prayer because we can tell God thank you even before we have received that which we're thanking God for. It's literally a post-miracle praise and a pre-miracle prayer. prayer. You see, oftentimes we consider praise amongst the faithful. We consider praise to be giving thanks to God for what God has already done. But I need you to know that when you're dealing with God, you don't have to wait to see how it's going to work out. You don't have to play let's make a deal with God that, God, if you bless me, when you bless me, then I'll give you glory. But rather, the Apostle Paul powerfully and poignantly commends this phrase to the church at Philippi when he says, listen, do not worry about anything, but by everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, listen, let your requests be made known to God, and the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. In other words, Paul says you don't need to worry because you have an antidote to worry, and that's called prayer. And when you pray, you can make your requests known to God. And as you're making your requests known to God, you should do so with thanksgiving. You should give God thanks in advance, even as you're still spelling out the specificity of the particularity of the need you need God to address in your life. Why? Because faith says that I don't have to wait to see how God moves. God's credit is good enough that I can thank him in advance for what I know he's going to do. Here's what the scripture says. He says, when I pray with thanksgiving, then the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard my heart and my mind in Christ Jesus. Literally, when I have the opportunity to worry, rather, I'm going to pray. And in my prayer, I'm going to make my requests known to God. And as I'm making my requests known to God, I'm going to give God thanks for answering every issue. And the reason I know he's going to answer the issue is before I get the answer, I'm going to get peace. And that peace is going to guard my heart and my mind so I can be at rest and I can be at comfort, knowing that sooner or later, somehow in some way, God is going to work it out for my good and for his glory. Listen, all I'm trying to get you to see, my brothers and sisters, is that as Bible believers, as twice born believers, we have the blessed privilege of offering to God thanksgiving prayers, prayers that are presumptive, prayers that are rooted in faith, that somebody named Jesus is going to hook me up, that thanksgiving prayers operate on the idea that it's God's good pleasure to bless his children. Thanksgiving prayers work on the basis of the word that we receive from Jesus in Mark 11:24, when he says, whatever you ask in prayer, listen, believe that you have received it. In other words, brothers and sisters, I have to pray in faith, because without faith, it's impossible to please God. And the greatest expression of my faith is thanksgiving. In other words, if I'm praying believing God, then I tell God thank you, then that shows that I believe what I just asked God for. I feel my help coming in the house. All I'm trying to get you to see, my brothers and sisters, is that we have the blessed opportunity to thank God in advance for blessings that are yet on the way. And there's one more particular passage I want to raise to your consideration. It's found in John's Gospel, the 11th chapter, wherein we find Lazarus, the Bible who describes the one that Jesus loved, has transitioned from sickness to death, and then from death to the grave, and then from the grave to decomposition. The Bible says that as Jesus arrives upon the scene, he immediately assesses the circumstance and gives this command, this imperative. He says, roll away the stone. But Lazarus's sister Martha said, Master, he's been dead for 4 days now. Surely his body stinks. Surely he has been decomposed. The problem for Martha is that she's operating only in the natural, and she's yet to allow the concept of the supernatural to enter into her mind, to know that despite how bad it is and how ugly it is and how foul it is, that there's nothing out of the reach of the anthropomorphic hand of God to turn around and to make new that which has been destroyed. Here it is. The Bible says that Jesus then has to correct her and says to her, listen, did I not tell you that you would see the glory of God if only you believe. Brothers and sisters, the Bible says at that, the people decided to take Jesus at his word and they rolled away the stone. And here's the part I want you to focus in your sermonic spotlight on. The Bible says then that Jesus said, "Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I said this for the benefit of the people standing here that they may believe that you sent me." Jesus was saying, listen, I know, God, I can tell you thank you because we've already had a conversation. I already know it's done in the spirit, but I'm saying this vocally. I'm saying this out loud because I want the people to understand and be able to connect the dots between you and me so that when the miracle happens that I'm already thanking you for, that I've already talked to you about, they'll know that you have sent me. Watch this real quick. The Bible says that Jesus does several things in this one phrase when he says, "Lazarus, come forth." When he makes that statement, "Lazarus, come forth," listen, the Bible tells us that Jesus really is causing three things to happen supernaturally and simultaneously. The Bible says, first of all, that he brings reconstitution, restoration, and resuscitation. Let me try that again. That when Jesus declares, "Lazarus, come forth," in order for the miracle to happen, there must be reconstitution, restoration, and resuscitation. Let me go to work here and unload my little red wagon. First of all, there's reconstitution. The Bible says that Jesus declares, "Lazarus, come forth." But remember, he's been dead for 4 days. Now, in order for you to appreciate the state of Lazarus's physical body, it would be really helpful if you've been in the DMV for a little while. Because if you've been around here for a while, by now, you've learned a little something about Maryland crabs. And one of the things you should have learned by now is that we do not cook dead crabs. Why? Because we understand that as soon as a crab dies, within just a matter of minutes, its flesh begins to spoil, and there's nothing worse than eating a spoiled crab. Well, Lazarus has not been dead for minutes or even hours or even a few days. The Bible tells us he's been dead for 4 days, which means that if Lazarus comes out the grave in his current state, then he's going to come out looking like something from a horror movie. Therefore, in order for Lazarus to be fully restored, the first thing that must happen is that Jesus must reconstitute his physical body. And I'm preaching this right now to somebody who may have experienced some decomposition in your own life. Maybe there's been decomposition in your finances or decomposition in your relationships. Maybe your smile has become decomposed, or your swagger has become decomposed, or your strength has become decomposed. I've got good news for somebody from glory today, which is to know that no matter what state you're in, I serve a God that can reconstitute and reform you and reshape you and put you back together again. My God, I just want to testify that in my own life, I've had some things to fall apart. I've had some dreams to be pulled apart. I've had some works of my hands to be broken apart. I've had some challenges in my life, but I need you to know that during the darkest times of my life, during the darkest times, during this season of COVID, I need you to understand that I knew that I had a resource that I could not reach with my hand, that I had a resource that I could not download off the internet, that I had a resource that I could not purchase in a mall, that I had a resource in my relationship with God that could bring it all back together again. I need to know, is there anybody watching me right now that can be a witness to the fact that when you allow God space, he can give you double for your trouble and restore that which the cankerworm and the palmer worm sought to decompose in your life. Can I testify? Because I'm at that age now where I injure easily. All back in the day, in order for me to get hurt, I'd be going up for a dunk and somebody low cut me. But now if I sleep in the wrong position, I may not be able to function the next day. And so I found myself having
having an issue with my shoulder. And so I went to the orthopedic doctor, and he said to me, listen, I know other doctors want to operate on you, but I don't get down like that. He said, I operate in what's referred to as regenerative medicine. That means rather than cutting you up, I'm going to inject something in you that will cause the cells of your body to reform themselves and restore themselves and reconstitute themselves so you'll be able to function again. Well, brothers and sisters, I don't have a vial to give you of a vaccine or of any medicine that can restore you, but I do have the blood of Jesus, and what can wash away my sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. I felt my help coming. The Bible says that Jesus declared Lazarus come forth. And the first thing that he had to do, therefore, was to reconstitute his physical body. But secondarily, Jesus could not simply stop with a reconstituted body. He had to move forward to restore Lazarus' soul. I want to remind somebody who may be an alumni from Sunday school that when you read Genesis, you discovered that when God created Adam, he created him by forming and shaping him from the dust of the earth. But the Bible tells us that Adam was not yet alive because God had to do one more thing. He had to breathe into him the breath of life, the ruach. And when he breathed in him the breath of life, the Bible says that Adam became a living soul, which tells me that Lazarus was more than simply flesh and blood. He also was spirit. And can I tell you, my brother, can I tell you, my sister, that without going to ancestry.com, you got something in common with Lazarus, because you also are more than merely flesh and blood. You are also spirit. You better hear what I'm saying. You may be able to bench press 500 pounds in the gym, and if you go to the doctor, they may say that your blood work is in order and your EKG looks real good. But at the end of the day, my brothers and sisters, if you are not spiritually right with God, if you don't have a saving relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ, if the Holy Ghost is not resident in your life, then you're just like the walking dead. I feel like preaching. The Bible says that Jesus declared Lazarus come forth, which meant that he had to restore not simply his body, but also his soul, that he had to do something spiritually. And can I tell you that maybe the reason you can have all the money and all the designer clothes and all the friends on social media and still feel empty is because there's yet a spiritual void in you. You've got a little hope, but you've lost your faith. Hear what I just said. You've got a little hope, but you've lost your faith that God is still working things out in your life. Now, don't get me wrong. Hope is important, but you need more than hope. You need faith. Hope is high school. Faith is college. Hope is amateur. Faith is pro. Hope is feeling. Faith is believing. Hope is required. Faith is essential. Hope is Hampton, and faith is Howard. You're not hearing me. I'm trying to tell you that until you matriculate to the level of faith that allows you to move where you can't see where you're going, you're yet to go to where God wants you to be. For the word says we walk by faith and not by sight. I need another witness in the house. Several weeks ago, I was sitting at home with my darling daughter, Alexandra, and we were watching one of her favorite movies on the Disney Channel, The Jungle Cruise, starring Rocky Johnson's son, The Rock. And during the opening scene, he's a riverboat captain, but his problem is that the debt collector has removed the engine from his boat because he had failed to pay his debt. Now watch this. When they removed the engine, the boat didn't sink. The boat still floated, but the problem was without the engine, the boat could not go another further. Well, can I tell you, without faith, my brother, without faith, my sister, you cannot go any further than you already are, because faith animates you and faith energizes you and faith propels you forward when everything in you wants to give up and throw in the towel. I got to get out of here. But the Bible says that Jesus declared Lazarus come forth. And in doing so, he reconstituted his body. He restored his spirit. But there was one more thing he needed to do, which was to resuscitate his consciousness. You see, understand that even if his body is moving, you can be what's referred to in medical terms as brain dead. You got to have something going on. You got to have a new level of consciousness. And when I say consciousness, I don't simply mean that you have mental function, but that means that you have a moral compass and that you have a faith sensitivity, that you don't simply live according to the culture, but you live to the consciousness of Christ, because he's called you to be a disciple. He's called you to be the head and not the tail, above and not beneath, which is not simply a position of power, but it also is a position of servants. Consciousness, listen, is the coherence of knowing who you are and where you are. Consciousness is being fully present and fully actualized. And many of us have family members with diseases like dementia and autism, where they have psychological and psychiatric conditions. And the problem for people like black folks is that oftentimes we don't want to talk about it, and therefore we continue the stigma. But the truth of the matter is, brothers and sisters, we ought to shine the light on what's going on in our homes and going on in our families, so that we can then take the stigma off and treat these issues like we treat all other kinds of issues. The truth of the matter is, brothers and sisters, all of us have some dysfunction in us, whether we've been diagnosed or not. And I need you to understand that until you fully submit to the word, the will, and the way of God for your life, you are yet living beneath your privilege. I don't care if you have more degrees than a thermometer. If you don't have a saving relationship which compels you to conform yourself to the image and likeness of the Lord Jesus Christ, you are still spiritually unconscious. That's why there are certain people that can have billions of dollars but still wake up every day still just looking to make more money. It's because they have no spiritual consciousness. When you have no spiritual consciousness, my God, you'll lie, cheat, and steal. You'll manipulate relationships. You'll use people on your job. You'll play with people's emotions for sport, because you are disintegrated. You don't have full integration as a whole individual, and as a consequence, you're always trying to complete yourself with some external force or individual. But I need you to understand, what you've been looking for in all the wrong places is found only in a real and saving relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. My God, when you have no spiritual consciousness, you can be the former most powerful person on the planet, and then you'll turn around and take a picture with a killer who shot 3 people in cold blood because you have no spiritual consciousness. What's your point, preacher? Here's my point. What does it profit a person to gain the whole world and still lose their soul? The Bible says that Jesus declared Lazarus come forth because he wanted to reconstitute his body. He wanted to restore his spirit, and he wanted to resuscitate his consciousness. But here's the thing, and I'm done. What you must understand, my brothers and sisters, is that there is a fundamental difference between what happens to Lazarus and what happens to Jesus. You will recall that after Lazarus is raised, the Bible tells us he becomes prima facie evidence of the saving and delivering power of the Lord Jesus Christ. But remember, after a few years, Lazarus died again, because at the end of the day, he had only been reconstituted. He'd only been restored. He'd only been resuscitated. But when Jesus died, he was more than all those things, because Jesus was resurrected. And what does it mean to be resurrected? It meant that when Jesus died, he didn't die of natural causes. He could have called down 10,000 angels to rescue him from that place, but he decided to die. He wasn't always tempted, but he knew no sin. He didn't die for his sins. He died for your sins and mine. He died, and they put him in a borrowed man's tomb, and he stayed dead all day Friday, stayed dead all day Saturday, but early Sunday morning, he was raised with all power in his hand. He was raised to stoop no more, that at the name of Jesus, every knee must bow, and every tongue must confess that Jesus is Lord to the glory of God the Father. You want to know why I have praise despite what's happening on Wall Street? You want to know why I have a positive disposition despite what's happening in the politics? You want to know why I can keep my head up despite what's going on in my life, it's because I have a saving relationship with the resurrected Christ. And if any man, if any woman be in Christ, he is, she is a new creature. Old things have passed away, and behold, all things have become new. So long, Howard. May the Lord bless you real good. I gotta leave you here, but on my way out of here today, I just want to encourage somebody to know that if you want to move forward in your life, you don't have to wait to see how circumstances work out. If you have a saving relationship with the resurrected Christ, you can thank him in advance. Tell him thank you now. He'll make it good down the line. Tell him thank you now. He'll pay you back later. Tell him thank you now. He's good for it. Is there anybody in this place that can help me testify that I've never regretted my faith in Jesus? My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name, on Christ, the solid rock I stand. All of the ground is sinking sand. Thank you for my good days. Thank you for my bad days, because when I look around, my good days outweigh my bad. Say yeah, yeah. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah to God. Tell him thank you in advance for the blessing, for the healing, for the saving, for the delivering. Yeah! Glory, glory, glory. Hallelujah. You ought to have a saving relationship that causes you to be able to tell God thanks in advance for your assistance. Let me pray for you right now. Father, in the name of Jesus, I give you glory and I give you praise that I serve a resurrected Christ. That God, you raised Jesus from the grave to let me know that you can raise me from every circumstance and from every sinful situation. In the name of Jesus, I right now pray for the brother or sister who believes in God theoretically, but they don't know you personally because they've yet to accept your Son as their Savior. I pray right now, God, that they will move forward in faith, that they'll confess with their mouths the Lord Jesus Christ and believe in their hearts that you raised him from the dead. And because of their faith in your word, they shall be saved. And as they've been born again, God, you'll give them their first birthday gift. You'll give them the Holy Ghost, which will live on the inside of them and bring them into all truth. God, I thank you for all that you are and all that you're yet doing in our lives. I thank you in advance for souls coming into the kingdom. I thank you in advance for strongholds being destroyed. I thank you in advance for making ways out of no ways. I thank you in advance for giving strength to the weak. God, I thank you in advance for bringing peace where there is confusion. I thank you in advance for using us as your instruments of justice and righteousness. I thank you in advance that you're going to cause all things to work together for our good. God, I thank you in advance that you're stirring up the gifts of your children. I thank you in advance that there are yet people that have not turned their knees to Baal and are still serving you in gladness and are willing to give you all. In the name of Jesus, I thank you in advance for what you're doing amongst your people in the kingdom of God, and it is so by faith in Jesus' name. Amen. Brother, sister, if you are that answered prayer, if you're the individual that I was praying to be saved today, I pray right now that you'll reach out to those who are leading the chapel and that you'll be in touch with them, that they can show you in the word of God what salvation is all about, that you'll get to know the joy of loving Jesus for yourself. Brothers and sisters, I believe that today is the first day of the rest of your life. It starts when you just tell Jesus thanks in advance.
To thank God for, so
for blessings and so many open doors. Upon the mercies
you.
We thank you, Reverend Watley, for the very powerful and timely message. Let's prepare our hearts and minds for the benediction. We thank you, O God, for what our eyes have seen, our ears have heard, and our hearts have felt. And now I said to the one who stood at the gate, give me a light that I might go out into the darkness and into the unknown. And she replied to me, go out into the darkness, go out into the unknown, but put your hand in the hand of God, and God shall be for you better than light and much safer than a known way. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and give you peace, both now and forevermore. Amen.